Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.
Good evening. Welcome to Wheels Along the Road here at the brand new BCTV studio.
Yeah.
Ooh, it's so big and spacious in here, which
spacious.
You can't tell from that shot right there, but wow, this is cool. So we're glad to be back, everybody. And we missed you in September, but hopefully it was worth the wait when we get to tonight's topics. Of course it is.
I think so, too.
So anyway, this is Wheels Along the Road. I'm Kendra Cook. This is Dan Olsen.
Hello.
And Wheels Along the Road is brought to you by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles. And if you have not been to the Boyertown Museum, we hope you will come join us soon. There's our information there on the screen. We are at 85 South Walnut Street in Boyertown, Pennsylvania. You can send us an email, mail, M-A-I-L, at boyertownmuseum.org. You can give us a call, 610-367-2090, or please feel free to visit our website, boyertownmuseum.org, or check us out on Facebook. If you're on there, our Facebook page is pretty active, and we also have started to get a little more active on our Instagram account. If you're into that, we're on Instagram as well. And also, check out our YouTube channel. The Boyertown Museum has a really neat YouTube channel with just a lot of really neato stuff. We just added one within the past week, too. Hmm. So we talked about, believe it or not, we're a road transportation museum, but we just added a short little webisode on our YouTube channel about Chris Craft boats.
Whoa, cool.
Ooh, that was our latest Casing the Joint episode. So go check us out on YouTube. If you're watching on our show right now on YouTube, it's really easy to then just go in the search bar and search for Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles, and you can find all of our stuff there after you are done watching and catching up with your Wheels Along the Road episodes. So the museum is open 7 days a week, 9:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. And we're closed major holidays. And I'm trying to think here. I think the next really major holiday we have coming up is Thanksgiving Day. So plenty of time between now and then to come visit us. We are in the last couple days here of our World War II exhibit that we have going on in the lobby, so make sure you stop in and see that. And we also have a lovely Rosie the Riveter Rose Garden, which is still managing to bloom
in
October.
I saw that this morning, and
I know.
Surprisingly.
We planted these rose bushes in May. They had no flowers on them when we planted them, and they have not stopped growing more and more flowers this whole summer. They're still
blooming.
Going.
Blooming is the word.
It's beautiful, so come check it out. And if you have been by the museum lately, you may have noticed we're doing quite a bit of work on the exterior of the building. It almost is nearly unrecognizable at this point. New siding, new brick, new doors, and it's really exciting. We're getting the final stretches of our facade construction project, and we will be basically celebrating that project and our same space but new face on Saturday, November 6th. So stay tuned to our website, our Facebook page, for more information on that. We're going to have more details on that very shortly. And we're looking forward to it. So it's exciting. Exciting times at the museum, as always. There's always exciting stuff there. So we are going to proceed, I guess, with the program. And Dan, what do you have for us this evening?
I got some stuff.
You got stuff? I got stuff too.
Okay, cool.
You do your stuff first.
Okay, first of all, I'm going to read something. This page is stuck here. There we go.
Don't you hate when that happens?
Oh, I hate it. This is something I saw in a magazine, and I'll tell you where the magazine came from when I'm done here. But I'll read this, okay? It's been a bumpy road to riches, with a few derailments for some of the most touted electric vehicle startups. Top executives at, it mentions three different places, recently stepped down amidst various charges of fraud, misstatements to the SEC, which is Security and Exchange Commission, whose primary purpose is to enforce the law against market manipulation, okay? Mismanagement and or inability to meet business goals. Some analysts question whether the companies were ever ready for prime time, yet stock prices, perhaps fueled by amateur investors, have held throughout the dramaramas. You like that word? Isn't that cool? And at least for now, optimism reigns, with one of the companies promising trucks will roll, another company announcing a new factory, and a third company boasting of top reviews for its new battery electric semi-trucks. Okay? That is out of a trade magazine called Electrical Apparatus, and it's July 2021, so just handful of months ago. And the reason
recent,
I bring...
Recent history.
The reason I bring that up is because we have talked various times here and there about some of these old companies that built cars from, we'll say, 100 years ago, 110 years ago, that the startups were not really on the up and up, and people, you know, they would raise all this money and then leave town.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes it was private investors that got, that lost their money. Sometimes it was the towns themselves that would, you know, do things.
Yeah.
So I saw that and I said, there's a TV show there. And so what I did, I went in and looked up a bunch of companies from good old Reading, Pennsylvania that kind of had questionable backgrounds, or maybe not even questionable, but they had all these ideas of starting up and they didn't really get anywhere.
They couldn't get their feet
ducks
off
in
the
a
ground.
Row. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So I'm going to talk about some. I'm going to try to keep this brief because the final car is the main part here. Excuse the cough here. First of all, in 1900, there was a car called Eddie Mac, E-D-I-E-M-A-C, here in Reading.
Venture, I haven't heard of that.
Huh?
That doesn't sound familiar.
Well, you're not with it.
I'm not with it.
Okay, venture capitalized at $250,000 to build a steam automobile. One or two prototypes were built. They bought the former Reading bicycle plant. Okay, that's one of them.
Reading... The Reading Bicycle Plant.
And Irvin Langle had something to do with that Reading Bicycle Plant.
There's a name I know.
Mm-hmm. Then there was the Reading Steamer, 1901 through 1902. And it was formed by Irvin D. Langle. Company name, Steam Vehicle Company of America. 1902 creditors moved in, and another company called Meteor bought the company, including Langle. So now we're starting to weave a thing.
Oh, man, and they are all interrelated, it
so
seems.
The Meteor Steam Company was 1902 and 1903. So they took a Reading steamer, made it kind of bigger and higher priced and stuff. 1902, Philadelphia business was ready to place an order for gasoline companies with the company, unaware that the company only knew about steam cars. So there was a salesman who said, oh, sure, we'll build you a gasoline car. The people who designed them had no idea. Anyway, they canceled the order upon realizing it couldn't trust Meteor with building gas engine cars, so none of them were built. 1903, two Meteor steam cars were built for the New York Automobile Show. No orders were taken. They ended up bankrupt. So somebody from Reading, E.S. Yauss, bought assets and sold leftover parts. 1917, so we're skipping a few years, there was a car called Reading, organized as Reading Chassis and Motor Corporation, capital stock of $100,000 for the manufacture of motors, cycle cars, and automobiles. Manufacturer of any cars are doubted. Then we have the Speedwell, or Yokum, in 1904 to 1909. Yeah, we talked about, we talked about it here on this show. Might have been another.
I think we did, because that's the one, isn't that the one?
They were in West Reading is where they were building them.
Yeah.
And
Oak Brook.
Correct.
Yes.
Anyway, so in 1904, 1909, they built gasoline engines. 1909 announced that cars would be made in a new plant, like up in northern Pennsylvania. The venture failed soon after. Okay. I actually found another company in Hamburg that had a really interesting name, but I couldn't find any information. Okay. The main thing I'm going to talk about is a car called the Upton, and it's in Beverly, Massachusetts. It was made from 1902 to 1903. The Upton Machine Company was organized in 1900, the company itself. Call Cord Upton was the guy in charge, C-O-L-C-O-R-D. They manufactured planetary transmissions. 1900 and 1901, three experimental runabouts were built. 1902 and 3, production of a touring car of their own design was built, $3,500. 16 horsepower, four cylinder. You could show the first picture, shows one of them. And this is from 1903. There you go. And so that's what they were building at the Upton Machine Company.
In Massachusetts.
Okay. 1903 also, Cold Cord Upton leaves the company. The company revised the car, and they were still building transmissions. You go to the next picture, there'll be a transmission advertisement in there. There you go. And so you can see it's still Upton Machine Company in Beverly, Massachusetts. Upton leaves, so now they have the Beverly car, which is the next picture, is a Beverly car. Thank you.
Oh.
And this is interesting. A 22 horsepower engine, four cylinder. From their catalog, acetylene brass headlights fitted to swing with the forward wheels, thereby throwing the light directly ahead at all times.
That's cool.
So that was kind of interesting. So the whole company in 1905 was reorganized as a Beverly Manufacturing Company and continued just with transmission. So the Beverly car, that picture might be the only car that they made. I think that's a photograph there. Anyway, 1909, factory was sold to Cameron Car Company that stayed till 1920 building cars, trucks, and tractors. Okay. We're going to go back to Colcord Upton. What happened to old Colcord?
That's quite a name.
Yeah, it's hard to say.
I know.
The Upton part's easy. He went to New York City, and then he ended up in Lebanon, Pennsylvania. So here we are. Not Reading, but almost. Okay? But in New York City, he had the Upton Gear Company, where he designed a sliding gear transmission. Also, a water pump for automobiles. Got the attention of a gentleman called Milton H. Schneider of Lebanon. So they went, are you related to him? You're giving me that look.
No, I'm not, but that name sounds really familiar. Mm-hmm. have to check in with the...
Well, as I continue, maybe something
maybe
will hit
the monument. Burl on the tree. Huh?
Okay, so Milton, it was the owner of Keystone Manufacturing Company in Lebanon. Not to be confused with the Keystone Steamer, which was made by the Keystone Match and Machine Company, which made matches. Okay? They also made bicycles. Again, this
they
is...
They make everything over there.
This is the Keystone Match and Machine Company. Milton owned the Keystone Manufacturing Company. So it kind of gets confused. I have
yes.
it all written down in front of me.
Yes.
But anyway, so I hope you viewers out there are taking good notes. 1904, they contracted Upton. Milton contracted Upton to produce the water pump in Lebanon. You could show the next picture, shows a little advertisement there for the pumps, okay? Nothing really exciting with that. But in 1905, the property of Keystone Match and Machine Company was transferred to the Upton Motor Company. So they're kind of mixed up here, but it's, that's
that
all
probably
minor
made stuff. Looking this up really annoying.
Okay, so Milton Schneider had the mortgage. He purchased the property, you know, under the name of Upton Motor Company. That was in 1905. At that time, Schneider and Upton decided to produce a car. In August, you can show the next picture. August in 1905, 7 Uptons were made. There you go. And at $2,500 a piece, they had a 30 horsepower Continental 4-cylinder engine. Now, here's another cool thing. The body on that is a King of the Belgians body. I saw
wow.
that and got all excited. We've talked about that before, too. This
it is fit for the King of Belgium.
Yeah. And it was also mentioned that this had the swiveling headlights.
This one does, too.
Right. But it doesn't have it. I saw a couple advertisements for this, but they didn't really mention advertisements. So I took their word for it. Anyway, that's in 1905. Later on that year, working capital was a problem, and the company was reorganized. Okay, now red flags are starting to pop up. 1905, Lebanon Motor Works was formed. 8 more cars were produced at $3,000, $500 more. The engine now was 40 horsepower.
That's a good chunk of change
to 40.
Back then, too.
Oh, yeah.
My
okay.
goodness.
1906 in January, plant was closed for a few days, reopened again to a wealthy New York stockholder, which could mean anything really, because you get wealthy stockholders from New York and they have different ideas. On,
oh, yes.
You know. Okay, 1906, 33 Uptons were sold. One of them was a custom built runabout with 2 4-cylinder engines mounted back to back.
Why? But if it was a runabout, it was not a King of Belgium body.
I guess he was the only one on the block with that 2 4-cylinder engine. Who knows?
Something.
1907, there was a Riviera car made. That was the brand name.
Okay.
By the same company, though, a Model B 5-passenger touring designed by Schneider. That was like $1,850, so that was a cheaper, had a 20 horsepower motor, so small. That was 1907. 1907 also, hoping to save the company, there was a contract for 700 New York City taxi cabs.
Yes.
But it fell through and that was the end of that company.
Man.
Now, here's the like really cool part. Especially seeing what today is.
Yeah.
And especially what tomorrow is. This I got from the Standard Catalog of American Cars, which most of this information came from.
Great book.
Mm-hmm.
Very useful.
Quote, reportedly, the factory was taken over by the Hershey Company and chocolate kisses were made there for a few years thereafter. And I say this is important because Hershey starts tomorrow, the Hershey car show.
How many days till Hershey Day?
Oh, like minus. It's there, okay? And I also came across a short article online by a Davis Shaver, who writes for Lebtown.com, which is Lebanon, I guess. Okay, and he writes, the factory would later be leased to Hershey Chocolate Company as a wrapping facility prior to being purchased by the Jubilee Ministries in 2000. The plant had been home to Milson Mills. So it seemed like it was the factory, Hershey, Milson Mills, and then Jubilee Ministries, which is still there now.
In Lebanon?
In Lebanon. And actually, Jubilee Ministries, the little side note, is they're like a non-for-profit, and I think they help out the families of people who are in prison and such.
Yes, it's kind of like a Goodwill. You can go there and mm-hmm. buy secondhand yep. clothes.
And it's pretty big organization, bigger than I thought.
I do believe that my dining room hutch is from the Lebanon Jubilee Store.
There you go.
Knew that once.
So I looked it up, and in 1907, Hershey began the manufacture of Hershey Kisses. And this company, Upton, ended in 1907. So you figure, I don't know.
I got to look this up.
Look it up.
My husband got the hutch. I don't know where exactly in Lebanon it is.
I looked it up. I found the address. It's easy. I think it's near a road.
Really?
Yeah. Yep.
What easy access. Yeah. Well, there's a couple of those stores.
Yes. Yes.
When I lived out in that area, I went to the Myerstown one quite frequently. Mm-hmm. But yeah, there's the big one, I think, it's mm-hmm. in Lebanon.
Okay. And that's it. So no TV reference, but the Hershey Kiss thing.
That's pretty good. You know, I was looking at this one photo that you have of the Beverly.
Yes.
And it says down there in itty bitty tiny print, member of National Association of Automobile Manufacturers. Mm-hmm. Is that that's the Selden patent, isn't it?
I believe so, yeah.
Interesting.
ALAM.
I always like seeing that. I don't know.
It's and I think we have some vehicles with the actual nameplate on it.
We do. Our Pullman Touring has a Selden.
I was thinking the auto cars did.
I was going to say something else does too, and I'm thinking it's the auto car. The Acme supposedly was built under the Selden. Well. None of them were really built under the Selden patent. That's mm-hmm. the whole problem. But I've never seen the tag on the Acme. I've never been able to find it.
I think the Middleby, the dashboard was bought at Jewel Administration. that was bad. That's something we joke
that explains
about.
Explains a lot.
Because our Middleby has a dashboard that is very authentic to the car and to the time period. It looks like it was made from a tabletop, Formica. Hey, Formica.
Genuine wood grain Formica.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway.
All right.
That's it. That's what I have.
All right. Well, I am actually, at some point, also going to get to a shady business practice, but... I have a little ways to go yet. But Dan.
What?
How did you get to school as a young lad? How did you get?
Did I tell you this recently?
I was telling
somebody. I rode a taxi.
Did you really?
My next door neighbor, he didn't really have a taxi. He had a car, but we called it a taxi. And there was like five of us little neighborhood kids went to kindergarten.
Aw. Mm-hmm. So you got to ride in a car.
Yeah, well, and being it's my next door neighbor, I knew if I made a mistake, if I was bad, my parents would know right quick.
Yeah, oh yeah. Just a hop, skip, and a jump to the next house.
Our kindergarten class was in the municipal building right next to the police station. Oh, yeah.
So the fear. Yeah. The horror.
Yeah. But that's, but yeah. And then after that, I walked.
And then you walked.
Mm-hmm. Uphill.
Both ways?
In the snow.
Yeah. My kids walk now, and it's uphill both ways.
That's, sure. Wasn't that far. So.
I am going to talk a little bit about really the history of school buses, and I'm not even sure why I started looking at this, but I couldn't stop once I started. Did that ever happen to you? You just
like,
can't stop
like
reading about the stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So now what I'm talking right now about kind of like before World War I, but in general, you know, getting to school is, it's kind of a loosey-goosey affair here. You just sort of...
We ought to put a positive spin, getting home from school.
That was probably more complicated.
Yeah, but you're going home.
That's true.
You get my drift.
So, you know, there's still a lot of, it's mostly one-room schoolhouses, so you don't even have a lot of kids that need to go to a particular spot. So a lot of kids are walking, or especially in the rural areas, they'll ride a farm wagon to school. You know, maybe someone mm-hmm. will get their wagon out and take a couple of the kids over.
Kind of like my neighbor taking us.
Exactly. You know. It was a modern day version of the farm wagon.
Yeah, you know, it was probably just parents getting together and say, hey, we take our kids.
Exactly. And then, okay. And you know, most kids too aren't maybe necessarily in school very long, not like they are now, like up until they're 18. That probably wasn't happening a huge amount anyway. But the first photo here, this is off the Smithsonian website. So this is an old school wagon, essentially, in North Dakota. Now, this was photographed in 1937, so I don't think it was really still being used at that point, but it survived somehow. But that's...
You know, it's when I drive, I have my phone in my car, and this is parked next to the phone.
I know.
I'm sorry. Continue.
It's so you can climb up the telephone pole and make a call.
Like Mr. Douglas.
Exactly.
Okay.
So the first publicly funded transportation for school children actually happens in Quincy, Massachusetts in 1869. And by 1910, there are 30 states that have a transportation program for students to use. And it actually takes until 1919 for all the states to start some kind of public funding for transporting school students. You want to guess what the last two states were in 1919? They couldn't be more different.
To transport students.
Yeah.
I'll say like New York and Wyoming.
Wyoming is one.
Okay.
And Delaware.
Delaware.
It took Delaware so long. They're so condensed there.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, whatever. Anyway, so what does that mean necessarily to have public funding up for transportation? Basically, it means that schools are going to start paying people to transport students to the school, or in some cases, maybe purchase a vehicle to do the transporting instead of just relying on family members to do it or the kids to walk themselves there or whatever. So then the debate starts, you know, what kind of vehicle should we be using to transport these kids? Well, a company called Wayne Works, I'm sorry, I had trouble typing this every time, Wayne Works. I feel like there's a word missing there, but whatever. Wayne Works of Richmond, Indiana, they come out with something called a school car or a school hack. Now, this is a horse-drawn omnibus, I guess, really. This is, they come out with this in 1886. You know, looks like a pretty basic carriage, basically, except it's going to seat a couple students. You know, obviously it's not going to hold as many as a bus holds now, but it's better than an open farm wagon, I guess.
Are they heaters in there? I see the pipe.
I know. I think it is.
And as well as the first picture you showed in Dakota. See, that has a pipe coming out.
I wonder if it has a potbelly stove in there.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Or some kind of little coal box or something. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'm sure they were cold.
Yep.
I mean, carriages are cold. Now, Wayne Works had been around for a while before this. This isn't their first vehicle, even, actually. Their first vehicle was in 1868. They started building wagons, like Conestoga-type wagons. Conestoga wagons started here in Pennsylvania, in the Lancaster area, but other places built them, including Indiana. But mostly they seem to really do agricultural stuff. This ad, you know, it's advertising their grain drills and seeders, steel road carts, wagons, mowers. They did threshers, rakes, you know, things like that. And they'd been around a while. And I don't know, they stumbled upon this school car thing, and that's really going to do well for them. They even do try in the early teens to build a car. It's called the Richmond. I think it's only lasts about 2 years, and that doesn't really go anywhere. They have found out that school cars are really what are going to make them money.
I have a question.
Yeah.
It says Model J1, the Merry Widow.
I know. Why would...
I don't know. That's interesting.
I do not know why you would call a car the Merry Widow.
No.
That doesn't sound, good. I don't know.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Not a King of Belgium body.
No.
At all. That looks like a pretty... a smaller, cheaper kind of car, at least in theory. So... the car thing doesn't last too long for them. But in 1914, Wayne Works takes that school hack and modernizes it and makes it a motorized vehicle. So they basically take an extended wheelbase Model T chassis and they build a wooden structure on the back, metal reinforced. So basically they wrapped the wood frame in metal, really.
Mm-hmm.
Still wood. And they added four bench seats. And the benches are along the walls. So you face the inside of the car or you face the kid on the bench on the other side. You're facing each other as you sit there. So it didn't seat a huge number of kids, but it's motorized. And that they built is considered to be the first motorized school bus. But of course, that's not quite the end of the story. So schools are getting funding now to transport students, okay? But this whole process of how they're doing it is still kind of messy and haphazard, really. Buses are typically sold to individuals who then go to the school and say, hey, I have this bus and I'll transport the kids for you. Or you may have someone that has a small fleet, you know, a few of these buses, and they go to these schools and say, you know, we'll transport X number of kids here every day to the probably one-room schoolhouse. So bus companies are selling to individuals, and it's just kind of, and there's, you know, there's no ease to making that process go any smoother than, like, if you were to go out and buy a car at the time. It's just kind of a pain. But there's other stuff going on that's going to start making the schools rethink how they do that. So one of the things is that one-room schoolhouses are starting to decline as far as how many are being run. So in Indiana specifically, where Wayne Works was located, in 1920 there were 4,500 one-teacher schools. So, you know, one-room schoolhouse.
And that was in that,
that
one?
That was 1920.
One county.
One state.
Oh, one state.
That's 4,500. But by 1945, so after World War II, it goes down to 616. So there's just the rural areas, the population's dwindling. More people are moving to the urban, or now, even after World War II, suburban areas. Roads are getting better as well. And with things like school buses starting to be used, you know, students are able to go further for school. You know, they can now maybe go 15 miles when before, if you were walking, you weren't going to walk 15 miles one way probably. So there's also the bus companies are actually starting to improve the safety of their products because they feel this is going to appeal more to parents and educators and will kind of convince them, hey, my school needs buses. Hey, school, you need to go get these nice, safer buses to transport my kid around. So a couple of other people are doing stuff too besides Wayne. There's an Albert Luce who had a Ford dealership in Georgia, and he comes up with the first bus that uses steel panels. Now it still has a wood frame, but he starts using the steel panels. And this is considered the beginning of the Bluebird Body Company, which is still around.
Yep.
Actually, my kids, when I took my youngest to daycare today, they have a small bus that takes the school age kids to school in the morning, and there on the front was the Bluebird logo. So they're still around today. And so that's Albert Luce. He's doing stuff. Wayne Works is seemingly inspired by this use of metal. So in 1930, they come out with the first all-steel school bus. And this adds a little before then. This is 1926. But they come out with an all-steel school bus, and as an option, you can have it with safety glass. But that's just an option at that point.
What year again?
That would be 1930.
Okay.
Now, there's another bus company called Superior Body Company, and now they're in Ohio. They're the first company to make both the all-steel body and the safety glass standard, and that's 1931. Wayne Works, it just wasn't, the safety glass wasn't a standard yet, so we get to give that nod to Superior. And by the mid-30s, Wayne Works adds collision rails around the body at the passenger seat level. So there's another layer of safety. There's a 1929 ad. And by 1933, all of Wayne Works's buses are built entirely of steel. So you can see their ads are really kind of hammering home how safe their buses are, that you, the parent, should expect your kid to be transported in something as safe as can be. Poor, precious little Johnny needs to get there, get to school safely. Early all-steel Wayne bodies were assembled using bolts, no rivets, and they were usually shipped completely knocked down to a Wayne distributor. And that distributor would then assemble the body and mount it on the customer's chassis, which I thought was interesting. This gave the firm an advantage. I'm not really sure why necessarily, maybe other than maybe it made it a little cheaper. I don't know if the shipping was cheaper, if they're not having to transport an entire, I mean, it is an entire bus, but it's probably a little easier to put on a freight train or something.
And maybe, you know, they didn't, Wayne didn't have the cost of actually assembling it either.
That's true. The guy at the distributor is probably cheaper than the laborer. At the Wayne factory.
Maybe that's why.
It's interesting. I'm not sure why they did
research that.
Yeah. So Wayne still has an issue, though, with all this that's improving. They're making these safety improvements, and the schools like them. However, there's still no statewide standards for buses, much less national standards. So this is a problem for Wayne, actually, and other manufacturers, too. There's an early school bus. You can see that's not really what we think of when we think of a school bus.
And an early school.
Very. Look, there's that telephone
wire crooked.
Again. It is. This is actually, that photo is from West Virginia. Since there's no standards, that means that every district basically can get any bus that they want. So Wayne and these other bus companies are basically saying, you know, if you had standards that we had to follow, that means we could mass produce them, which means we could keep the costs down. And, of course, that would also help their profits. But also, they say it would help the school districts because it would make the bus cheaper if they didn't have to just, you know, keep making all this custom stuff. So that's when this gentleman, enters the picture. This is Dr. Frank Cyr, C-Y-R, sir. I'm going to call him Dr. Frank because I don't know.
Okay. He's a happy fellow.
He looks like a nice guy, doesn't he? So Dr. Frank here is a professor of rural education. So he was born in 1900 in a sod house in Nebraska. So very rural Nebraska. And he became a teacher and later... actually, a teacher in South Dakota, and then he came back to Nebraska and was a superintendent there for a while. And then he went on to go teach eventually at the Teachers College at Columbia University. And he's a published author. He's basically an expert on rural education. So anyway, he sees this all the time, and he's concerned about the safety or the lack thereof in transporting students to their schools. So in 1939, he gets a $5,000 grant from the Rockefeller Foundation, which that's about $95,000. That's a good bit of money. So that he can hold a conference at the University of Manhattan to develop school bus standards. So this conference involves at least one transportation official from all 48 states, because we don't have Hawaii or Alaska yet, and engineers from companies like Bluebird and Chevrolet and Ford, and engineers from Pittsburgh Paint and DuPont. So this conference of 1939 basically comes up with 44 national standards to be used for school bus driving, for school buses, but the big one is color. That's why we had DuPont and Pittsburgh Paints there. So this is where the official school bus color comes from. It was called National School Bus Chrome Yellow. At some point, they changed it to National School Bus Glossy Yellow.
Okay.
I thought chrome sounded weird, but I guess they did too. That's why they made it glossy. And the lettering has to be black on school buses. So they chose this because they feel it's, well, it's bright. You know, it's very visible no matter the weather. And at times of day, you know, dusk and dawn, which is when a lot of these things are out and about mm-hmm. doing their stuff. So supposedly, they at the conference, they hung paint samples all over from the ceiling, and they just started tearing them down as they eliminated the ones that they didn't like. And they ended up with 3 shades of yellow. And they came up with this. They allow slight variation because apparently yellow paint is very difficult to mix exactly the same. So, but it is on file with the National Bureau of Standards. And it has the little chemical thing there. You can look that up online. And I think Canada even now also has the same color. So, and Dr. Frank here said at the conference, the question was always, whenever something came up, will this standard improve safety? That was just the overriding theme of the conference. He also held a conference 3 years later in 1942 to work on school transportation policy in wartime, which is interesting. I'm assuming because, you know, just of the concern about things like air raids or maybe the impact of rationing or, you know, I'm not sure. But anyway, when they choose this yellow color at the 39 conference, 35 states immediately switch to painting the buses yellow right away. And the others pretty much follow suit a while afterwards. But it's not until 1974 that the entire country goes over to yellow. And the last state to hold out was Minnesota, which had its buses painted Minnesota Golden Orange.
Which probably was very similar to
probably wasn't that far off. But, oh my gosh. So I got on the Minnesota School Bus Association or something website, and there's a timeline there, you know, of like, you know, moments in innovations in Minnesota school buses, and that date is on there, and it's like they're still angry about it, I think. It's like Minnesota's still a little peeved about this.
Wow.
You know, the thing says, you know, Minnesota was alone in this battle and we lost. And this really isn't a great moment, but it should be noted that it marks a turning point when the rest of the nation decided to follow Minnesota's standards.
It probably has something to do with the state's rights versus the federal.
I don't know. They're pretty, you know, they're pretty chuffed about it now. It's a grudge today. Okay, so all this stuff is going on. You know, the better safety, and the school bus companies are saying, "Hey, come on, like, let's mass produce." And the roads are getting better, and everything, and basically the school districts realize they need to just basically get a better handle on their transportation. And in the 1950s, they start getting even more money to fund this kind of thing. So that's when a lot of them are going to start operating their own fleets and buying their own buses, hiring and paying their own drivers instead of having, you know, John Q Public down the street buy a bus and provide a service to the school district. So that's a photo from 1939 Oregon in the middle of nowhere. But there's a bus picking up some kids. And Bluebird, here is a shady business practice for you. Bluebird salesman Red Willie. You know you're going to get a shady something going on right away.
Okay.
So he was a salesman with Bluebird. Now, he had a scheme that he came up with for his company to win the lowest bid by basically getting in with a school official that's maybe having some rough times here, maybe needs a good win, mm-hmm. you know, to keep his job or whatever. Mm-hmm. And the school official would have a look at this bid I got from XYZ bus mm-hmm. company, and it's really high. But I'm going to leave it on my desk out. And then when another bus company comes, ABC bus company comes to give me a quote, they see this price there that I already got from XYZ, so they go a little lower because they know that I've got this high bid. But then Bluebird comes in and gives them the real price, which is a lot lower, but still high enough that this guy can get some grift. Hmm. I love it. That's good old Red Willy for you.
Yep, good old Red Willy.
So, real quick, we're almost out of time. We'll get back to Wayne here a little bit. I found this ad, which I think is just absolutely gorgeous. Now on my screen, it is yellow on the transferring to the TV. I think it looks more like that Minnesota golden orange, doesn't it?
Could be. Yeah, it's orange.
But it is that yellowy color. And then, you know, there's one kind of highlighting their evolution. This is from 1956. At the top, they call it in this a school hack. So a hack is kind of like a type of wagon, mm-hmm. basically. Mm-hmm. And then there's one from 1968. Now the top is a school bus. They did other kinds of buses too. Which don't have quite obviously the same standards. So, and then this Dan Olsen fellow, he came by the other week and he dropped off some photos for me. So this is a Wayne bus. There's a card in the window there that says, greatest safety in this Wayne all steel body. Do you know what year this is about?
Like 40, maybe, 1940.
Now, this is not a school bus. This is like a, you know, public transit bus or something. But the photo has an equipment by Baker stamp on the bottom corner. So Baker has all this, you know, cool stuff here that they basically can add to this school. I mean, there's a whole bunch of standard equipment, but then there's optional driver's non-glare curtain, a buzzer signal cord type, overhead hangar rails, double entrance step, directional lights, chrome wraparound rear bumper. Baker did the seating on here as well. But it says, you know, Wayne bodies are distributed by Baker Equipment Engineering Company. They are in Richmond, Virginia. That fooled me at first.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so that, you know, they could have put the bus together too, I'm sure, when it came there broken down. And then you had these photos too of a factory, which we're not sure what these are we? Is this Wayne?
I don't know.
It could be.
I looked and looked and looked for that one and the other one.
We don't really know, but they're really cool interior factory photos of these buses getting manufactured. Can you imagine the size of this building to fit all
and
buses?
I think in that one, that photograph, there's a whole bunch off to the left. There's a wall there and you can see beyond it.
It's crazy.
Like through windows or something.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my gosh. That's a huge building. That's enormous. And then, so what happened to Wayne? Well, real quick, because I got 3 minutes. We're in Dan's heyday now here. So there were two lawyers, Newton. Do you know how to say their names? Newton Gleckel
Okay.
And Harold Drimmer. Now, they had a law firm. Why they're getting into this, I don't really know. They purchased Wayne Works in the early 1950s. Now, before then, Wayne had bought two companies, A.V. Miller and Meteor, and they made not Meteor Steam of Reading, though. These were
ambulances and hearses.
Yes, yep, hearses and ambulances. So Wayne had already purchased those. Gleckel and Drimmer bought Wayne. And then in 1956, according to this lovely Divco history book that you gave me.
Wow, I loaned you.
Yeah, I know, that's why I brought it. So I'm giving it back now tonight. I know, you wouldn't give that. they basically kind of backdoor engineer a buyout of Wayne Works by Divco. And now Gleckel and Drimmer all of a sudden own quite a bit of stock in the new Divco Wayne. And they kind of wanted to do this, I guess. They felt it would be a recession-proof business because no matter what, people are going to die. People are going to be sick and need to go to a hospital. Kids still need to go to school.
People need to be transported.
And people need milk.
Milk, okay. Yeah.
But I guess they felt not all of those are going to fail. Mm-hmm. You know, one might slow down or something, but the others are going to be fine. So, yeah, that was in 1956 that Divco becomes Divco Wayne. Of course, they built some buses. I didn't see school buses in here. It was all like transit buses. Mm-hmm. But this one is fun. I really liked this panoramic one. I want to take a ride in that. It's awesome. Anyway, in 1964, Divco Wayne is going to leave Richmond, Indiana factory, but the community basically protests and raises funds for a new $5 million state-of-the-art facility, which closed in 1993. So that is the school bus slash Wayne story, in a sense. And we are out of time here tonight. And thanks, Dan.
You're welcome.
And thank you all for joining us. And thank you to BCTV for giving us these cool new digs here in Reading. And we will be back next time with more cool stuff. In the meantime, please do visit us at the Boyertown Museum. We would love to see you.
Come visit me at Hershey tomorrow, too.
Go find him.
Yeah.
Go find me on Thursday.
At the bottom of the stairs. That is the pedestrian bridge.
He'll be there Wednesday. I'll be there Thursday. Come find us. Yep. Give us a pop quiz. Maybe.
Make it easy.
Make it a really easy one. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you next time.
Wheels Along the Road is supported by the Boyertown Museum of Historic Vehicles.